Welcome to today's webinar, Mindful Leadership, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. My name is Kara Fleury, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Monica Thakrar, Organizational Consultant and Coach. Before we start, I have a few reminders for the audience. Questions are welcome throughout today's webinar. Simply type them in the question area as you have them in real time. I will hold on to all questions until the speaker has finished the presentation. We will begin the Q&A session in the last 20 minutes of the call. Please note that today's presentation will be recorded and made available to all registrants within 3 days on our YouTube channel. And additionally, I will be passing along a copy of the recording in my follow-up email over the next few days. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via that same question drop-down in your control panel. Without further ado, I'd like to go ahead and introduce our presenter. Ms. Thakrar is an organizational consultant and coach with over 15 years of experience focused on strategy, organizational change management, leadership development, training, executive coaching, and mindfulness. Monica brings to all of her work a deep understanding of leadership and organizational development based on years of working with organizations, leaders, and managers on leading change, reading high-functioning teams, enhancing leadership capacities, and working across organizational silos. She has worked with individuals and organizations to enhance their effectiveness, realize greater efficiency, and develop increased capacities in leading people, change, and organizations. Monica has worked with clients in the private, public, and international sectors. A few clients include MedStar, Columbia University, and NASA. Monica has also volunteered with the Art of Living Foundation, teaching breathing and meditation techniques for the last year. Monica, we're excited to get started, to have you back presenting another webinar, so I will go ahead and turn this over to you.
Thank you so much, Kara. I am really happy to be here. I'm a Georgetown alum, 1996 undergrad, and I did one presentation last year, and it's been such a thrill to be part of the alumni community and such an opportunity to give back to the Georgetown Hoyas, since I received so much from the university over the years. I'm excited today to present to you this topic on mindful leadership. It really is a topic that's near and dear to my heart. In addition to teaching meditation for the last year, I've been a practitioner of meditation and mindfulness types of activities for the last 10 years or so. My journey started as I started my business. I really needed some more of these mindfulness practices because I noticed the stress and the lack of energy because I was constantly focused on being a leader, supporting my clients through coaching and teaching and consulting, and really needed some of these tools in order to help me be the best coach and trainer, but also leader that I could be for my clients as well as the communities around me. So this really has been a personal journey for me, as well as now bringing this out to the leaders that I work with every single day when I'm in collaboration with them in terms of supporting their efforts. So before we get started, though, I really want to get to know who's on the line and what your experience might be with some of these tools. So we just have 3 short questions. We're going to take some quick polls. The first one is we're going to get started with is just I want to get a sense of the type of industry that you're in. I know that you are probably working in all sorts of capacities. As I know, Georgetown alumni are very adept and competent. So I'd love to understand whether you're working in government, business, nonprofit, perhaps you're still a student. And we have another category in case I didn't touch on any of those. So please just take a couple seconds to show me what kind of industry that you're a part of. That'll help me as I'm framing the presentation going forward. Carol will be collecting some of these poll results, and I think you'll be able to see it up on your screen as well.
Yes, Monica, we do have the results. It looks like 15% of our audience are government. Can you see this?
No, I cannot see this.
Okay. 15% government, 37% business, 19% nonprofit. We do not have any current students on the line, and 30% fall into the other category.
Okay, great. So our second question then is I want to get a sense of how many years of leadership have you had under your belt? This again will give me a little sense of how to tailor the conversation. So if have you had 0 to 5, 6 to 10, 11 to 15, 16 to 20, 20 plus? I know there's probably some experienced folks out there as well. So just give me a sense of how long you've actually been in a leadership position or role. Leaders I know can often be in stressful situations, and so I'm hoping this topic's really resonating for you leaders out there.
Okay, so it looks like 28% of alumni on the line have 0 to 5 years of experience. It's the largest group. 5 to 10 years, 24% of our alumni. 17% of our alumni tied for both 10 to 15 and over 20 years. And 14%, our lowest percentage group, have 15 to 20 years experience.
Okay, great. Thank you. And just one more question, just so I get a sense. This is, what is your experience with mindfulness? There's a lot of tools and techniques out there, and I just want to get a sense. Are you a total novice, beginner, not really had much experience at all with mindfulness or any of the tools kind of related to that? Are you at a medium level? You've had some experience, some introduction, maybe a little bit of practice, but not complete beginner, and or are you a regular practitioner? So something that you're typically focused on or that you've had a lot of experience doing with all of the different mechanisms and tools there are out these days?
So Monica, it looks like our largest percentage group, 48%, have a medium level of experience, so some knowledge of it. 39% are beginners, and 13% feel that they are pretty much on a pro level of regularly practicing.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kara. So thank you for the information, folks. That's really helpful. It's always great to understand who is with me so that we can make sure that we're getting to the right information. So with that, let's get started. Just the agenda, the types of things that we're going to be covering is just a little background on what mindfulness actually is, a little bit of history and the beginnings of it. What are the benefits of mindfulness? Lots of data and research out there that I'll be going through on the benefits, as well as how is this being used in organizations. Lots of big organizations and companies have started to implement mindfulness in their organizations and have started getting a lot of traction in terms of research on the benefits and the applicability to organizations and leadership. We'll talk a lot about the benefits to leadership and how it really can tie in to leadership principles, as well as the emotional intelligence component. That's what EQ is. An emotional quotient we talk about is emotional intelligence, really a way to have people understand the benefits of mindfulness as a direct link to building the capacity of emotional intelligence. And as I presented last year on emotional intelligence, I'll talk through that a little bit too, that emotional intelligence is such a key ingredient for leaders to really become very, very successful. Even before the next steps, I will guide you through a couple of mindfulness activities. So you have a couple of tools that you can leave today with, and then we'll go into some next steps. So let's just get started. Let's just define mindfulness so that we're all on the same page. This is a definition that is out there that's saying paying attention in a particular way, on purpose, in the present moment, and non-judgmentally. John Kabat-Zinn, and I'll explain who he is in a moment, but mindfulness is really being in the present. So often we are, our natural tendencies of the mind are to be in two places, whether it's in the past, focused on all sorts of things I had done or should have been doing or regret not doing or doing, or we're in the future, right? We're making a checklist. I'm on this webcast, but I'm also multitasking and checking my emails or thinking through what I need to accomplish the rest of the day today. And so our mind's never, or not very often, right here, right now, in the present. And the non-judgmentally part really is focusing on how do we then make sure, even if we are in the moment, we're not criticizing ourselves for not being so much focused on what we should be doing and or thinking about something in the past. Okay, so that not judgment is also allowing and accepting whatever is going on for you at that particular moment. Okay, so that's where we'll start as the frame in terms of how do we talk about mindfulness. This is our level setting definition. And just a cute little cartoon, I always love this as well. You know, our minds are so often in multitask mode. We have so many things that we have to be doing. Our society is so busy these days, whether you're here in the U.S. or international somewhere. We're constantly on the go. And this has really gotten so much more traction with things like social media and Facebook. And I don't even know what's new out there. I'm still in the Facebook age, but I know some people are on Instagram and some others. But we're constantly thinking about so many different things at once. And so mindfulness really is getting us to back to single tasking and being very focused and deliberate and in the moment, focused on what it is here and now that we need to be doing. And there is some science out there that when we're multitasking, we almost lose 20 points in our IQ. I know I don't have 20 points to lose. I know I went to Georgetown, and you know there's a lot of smart people out there, but still, if we want to be working at the best of our capacity and in and around the potential that we have within each of us, we don't want to be losing our IQ levels based upon multitasking. So mindfulness really is a tool to get us back into the present so that we can be that much more productive and efficient. When we think about leadership, those are really two very important things to keep us on track and getting us to the outcomes that we want to accomplish. The beginnings of mindfulness, you know, there's certainly roots in a lot of different faiths out there, including Buddhism and many others. But mindfulness, as the term, really came into the mainstream in the 1970s with John Kabat-Zinn. He was the one that gave us the definition of mindfulness at the University of Massachusetts in the Medical Center. He really started focusing on the scientific credibility of mindfulness, and a lot of the data and research and the science started in the 70s based upon a lot of his work. He also began a program called the Mindfulness-Based Stress Reduction Program, MBSR for short. You can find these across the country now. He often, not just him, but people within that support him have these programs going on all across the country. And we're really where they've started documenting the health benefits of mindfulness. And so this really did start back in the 70s, but has been since then gaining a lot of traction. You've probably seen it on the news now, on the front of Time magazine a couple of years ago, in Harvard Business Review. It's just getting traction across even mainstream media now for the benefits and the helpfulness and how much data and science there is now to back up the essentials of mindfulness in terms of the benefits. So this is where it started. If we start thinking of the benefits, it's just a high level emotionally, really focusing on stress reduction, anxiety, and depression. There's lots of data out there now that meditation can help. There's so many people out there now on depression medication, anxiety medication, where mindfulness techniques can really start helping people get off of those tools, those types of things as they practice more and more of this. Really helps improving moods, lessening negative thinking and distractions. You know, I mentioned my journey started just with the stress of starting a business. I really needed some of these tools to help me reduce the stress. But I also noticed that sometimes my moods would go up and down. And emotionally, some of the tools around mindfulness, which for me include things like breathing and meditation, have certainly enhanced and improved a lot of the emotional capacity I know is within myself and with people that I work with that have started using these tools. And really that's the link for us for leadership, because as a leader, that emotional quotient, that emotional intelligence really is such a critical tool for making us the best leaders that we possibly can be. And I'll show you some of the data around that moving forward. The second place where it really can help is physically. I mentioned the relieving stress. But there is now even data that shows that it helps in heart disease, lowering blood pressure, reducing chronic pain, improving sleep. There's data and statistics that show even chronic pain with some of these tools can start being lessened. And I know that some people I've worked with have had chronic issues, and the meditation is starting to help them. All right, so benefits on both sides, emotionally and physically. When we start thinking about mindfulness and organizations, I want to start here because there's many large organizations that have really embraced the idea of mindfulness. big, big companies like Google and Goldman Sachs, even the investment bankers, are starting to practice this. You'll see on this left-hand side a lot of even government agencies, even the military, really in helping veterans that are coming back from war, helping them with things like PTSD. Mindfulness practices are now starting to become very popular, and alternative therapies in terms of helping the veterans when they're re-entering into their normal lives back here in the U.S. Also, companies like Intel, Aetna, Bank of America. I just show you this to show you that it's growing and growing in popularity, even in the business community, and I'm going to give you a couple of examples of that. First one being Aetna. We know that they're a healthcare company. They have had, over the last number of years, 15,000 employees participate in at least one yoga or meditation class, and they've had some staggering results. They said they've had $9 million in savings since 2012 for the company based upon them, their employees going to some of these. Reduction in stress, improved sleep quality, reduction in pain. The big ones on a leadership side, in addition to those, are 62 minutes per week of increased productivity. Okay, so if you think that you need to get more work done and I don't have time to do mindfulness, I will debunk that myth right now, because actually doing mindfulness activities are actually going to help you become more productive. Your mind will be calmer, you'll have more energy, you know, any sort of emotional or physical issues will start declining, which will allow you to actually become more productive. They said that it's been worth $3,000 per employee per year. Okay, so imagine this if Aetna's doing it. Since this article came out, which was 2015, the data's on the bottom here, they've also started implementing this with some of their people they provide for. And so they're also expanding this out as well. The second example I want to show you is General Mills. They've had 500 employees attend their mindful leadership program. They have a 7-week course, and they too have also found increase in productivity, up from 23% prior to the course to 83%. Leaders and people going through it more able to eliminate tasks with limited productivity value. How often are we sitting and multitasking, but we're just deleting emails or responding to emails that we could have delegated to somebody else, or doing little things that they're not the most high value tasks that we need to be focusing on? They were able to eliminate that from 32% prior to taking the class to 82%. And with the senior executives, these last two statistics, better decision-making and better listeners. Okay, so if this isn't proving to you the benefits of this stuff in businesses, in large businesses that are highly successful, right, data is now here to back it up. This is no longer some woo-woo thing that, you know, alternative folks are doing out on the side. This is really coming into the mainstream, and there's proven data now to back this up. So just to summarize for leaders, you know, the science on the left-hand side I've mentioned, right, and stress reduction, increased productivity, better emotional reactivity, less emotional reactivity, so we're not reacting as much, which then leads to improved attention and focus, right? If we're really able to take all of those things that are all going on in our mind and really start focusing on one and being in the present, we're going to have better attention and better focus. When we think about leadership, all of these things then help some of the very specific leadership skills that I'm often teaching every single day to leaders all across the federal space and in the private sector. I've been teaching some organizations, their top 2,000 leaders at MedStar, top 2,000 leaders at Department of Labor. There's a cadre of us doing this work. But these are all the tools that we're helping to help them learn: effective listening skills, better ability to institute change, more effective team interactions, critical thinking skills. These are things we're talking to them every single day about. Okay, so what a great tool now to have in the toolkit to add to that when I'm talking to leaders as a way to help them bring these capacities to life. So the benefit to leaders is very strong in my mind, and it gives us a sense of how it can be applicable to what we're doing every day. So if we think of mindfulness and emotional intelligence, if you participated last year, if you've read any data on emotional intelligence at all, they often say that emotional intelligence is a key ingredient to leadership people growing in their leadership skills or becoming amazing leaders or wonderful leaders. The statistics often show that IQ gets you in the door into leadership or into an organization or into a role, but emotional intelligence is really what's moving people forward in their capacity to become effective leaders. Because emotional intelligence, if we think about it, is really all of the things that are dealing with how do we relate with people. Our soft skills, our emotional capacity to understand ourselves, others, and interact with them. And I'll go through a little bit more detail of what it all correlates to. But emotional intelligence is really such the key tool out there now for leadership potential. This is all based upon research from Daniel Goleman. He was an author. He has a book out there from the 90s that was called Emotional Intelligence, which really launched a lot of the emotional intelligence field that we've been teaching and studying and bringing to our leaders over the last 20 years now. And he also now has a new book called Focus. And a lot of this now he's starting to make the link between mindfulness and emotional intelligence. He says the tool of mindfulness really does two major things to help leaders. And he was just at an emotional intelligence summit back in May of this year, 2017, where he was making this exact link, saying that the two major things that mindfulness does is really training them on attention and focus. Okay, so if we start having more attention, more ability to focus on different things, on a task, on a problem, on a situation, and we have more ability to put our attention on it, it starts building two really key components of emotional intelligence. Self-awareness, we get to know ourselves better, we get to know what our feeling states are, how we're reacting to our feelings that might be coming up, what might be triggering us if things are coming up that we don't like or we do like. And the second component is empathy. And empathy is really then helping us to understand from a social perspective what are other people feeling. Both of these skills then are so critical in building emotional intelligence because they're a key component of knowing ourselves and regulating ourselves, but then also working with other people. So when we start thinking about this, we get to the sense that, you know, mindfulness is a key tool now. It's not just something that we can't really do anymore. We have to have emotional intelligence to be healthy leaders, and mindfulness is an easy way. We don't think it's easy, but I'll give you some tools in a moment for us to start practicing this. It can be an easy way to do this because it really starts building the muscles in the mind. Just like going to the gym to build our body, mindfulness techniques can be just like that for building our mind's capacity to build attention and focus. When we start thinking about the four quadrants of emotional intelligence, this is, again, by Daniel Goleman from his book from the 90s. Daniel Goleman breaks down emotional intelligence into four capacities. And he says that there are, when we think about the self and we first look at awareness, just understanding ourselves, the self-awareness is the first component. And he breaks it down into these three areas, increased self-confidence, accurate self-assessment, and emotional awareness. And in red, I've highlighted the ones that directly correlate to what mindfulness can control or help with. And I would argue it actually bleeds over into many of these other ones, but I wanted to give you just a sense of the three that we'll really talk about here. But with self-awareness, that emotional self-awareness, just understanding how are we feeling today? How are my emotions perhaps changing over the course? Or if something happens, what's my emotional state in reaction to that? So really just starting to understand how we're feeling and how is that showing up, and how is that showing up in the organization. And so often we don't want to talk about feelings in the workplace, but the data continuously shows us that emotional self-awareness and emotional intelligence is really critical for us to become good leaders. And in every single leadership class I train now, we often start with self-awareness. You have to know yourself first in order to then be influencing and impacting other people or your team, and then sort of going out to the wider circle of impacting an organization or even larger if you're working in bigger capacities out there. Okay, the second component of the emotional intelligence quadrant here is self. When we go to self and actions, when we start acting out in the world, how do we manage our own self? That's the second component of self-management. Here, as we start thinking about how do we self-control, meaning if we're stressed, how do we manage the stress? How transparent are we in our communications on how we're feeling or what's going on for us? How are we able to be authentic and genuine in terms of our communication skills? How adaptable are we? Achievement, initiatives, all those things that take our own motivation internally to actually get things done. Mindfulness has a direct link here too, especially with the self-control. So if we're noticing that something is getting triggered, being able to use tools like mindfulness. Now, let me just give you some ideas of the tools that I'm talking about. Mindfulness is a greater context to me than meditation. Meditation would be one tool under mindfulness. Breathing activities could be taking a walk in nature, could be just going out for listening to some music, something that's going to get you back into the present and not have your mind take over and be in multiple different spots. So often we can confuse mindfulness and meditation. To me, mindfulness is a broader context of many different things. But any of those tools could help with self-control in terms of managing your emotional state so that you're not reacting. Have you ever been in a situation where something, you've been triggered or something emotionally occurred for you and you launched? Okay, so you got very upset, frustrated, and started acting out towards other people. And as a leader, that does not go over very well. It doesn't go over well in many places, but in particular in the organization and in the workplace, the self-control is very, very important. The third component that he talks about is with others and awareness of others. He calls this social awareness. Here is really starting to understand more about how other people are feeling and what's going on for them, having just this general sense of what's going on for them. Empathy being the key one here that mindfulness can really help. The more we are in tune with ourselves and understand our own emotional state, the more we're able to be in the moment and also get an awareness of what might be going on for others. Empathy is that ability to really relate and put ourselves in the other person's shoes that we get a real good sense of what's going on for them. It includes things like organizational awareness and service orientation, but mindfulness really helps with this component of empathy. And then the last piece here on relationship management, this one I didn't highlight any with mindfulness, but I do honestly believe that all of them can be helped by having more mindfulness. So developing others, having influence over them, being a change catalyst, conflict management, right? Conflict management, if we're in a highly emotionally charged situation and we just act out on our emotional state, could really be damaging, right? So if we have more mindfulness and we're able to have self-control, that's also going to help with many of these things on the relationship management side. Okay, so really strong link for mindfulness and emotional intelligence. And I just want to walk you through, even at Google, their Search Inside Yourself program that they've launched over the last few years, which has gotten a lot of good press, and they've actually offered this even outside of Google, really has focused on this link of developing attention training, which is the foundation for emotional intelligence, and also increasing self-knowledge, and then creating useful mental habits. So Google's entire focus is on this link of leadership and emotional intelligence. So when we think of emotional intelligence, first tool I just want to introduce you to, and this is called the state of mind. We've called it that. And I just want to get a sense here, just even as you're thinking about yourself right now in this moment, jot down for yourself. If you had to put yourself on a scale of +3, I'm in a great mood, happy as can be, everything's great, I love this panelist, I want to hear more, right? You're at a +3. +2, I'm feeling pretty good, everything's going pretty well, in a pretty positive, content state. +1, pretty peaceful, content, nothing too outrageously in terms of overly overjoyed, but in a pretty good place. 0, you're kind of at a meh, everything's fine, you know, not good, not bad. And then into the negative states, are you at a -1, not feeling so great, maybe I have a little headache, not enjoying this so much. -2, this is horrible, I'm in a really bad space, I've had a really stressful morning. -3, this is horrible. Okay, so if you just have to rate yourself right now, it's an easy tool to use for yourself or your staff to start thinking about emotional intelligence. Put yourself on a scale. Where would you put yourself? So just jot that down for a little moment. And now let's shift in, what exactly are some mindfulness tools? Because now that we know that there's benefits to it and there's an effect on emotional intelligence, as leaders, I want you to get some tools walking out of here that you can actually go back and practice. So I'm hoping that you're in a space where you're able to actually do a couple of these. We'll do two of them, this one and one other. Both of them will be probably combined 5 to 6 minutes, but I'll give you some sense of what some mindfulness practices are. This first one, if you could, just if you can, if you're in a space where you can close your eyes, I would do that. If not, at least put your feet someplace where you're in a chair and your feet on the floor, touching the floor, both feet, and really where you have a sense of you're comfortable on a chair and your feet on the floor. Okay, if you can, close your eyes. I'm just going to walk you through a little process. And so first, just start with taking a little deep breath in and out. And I just want you to start by beginning to noticing your feet. Notice your legs. Notice your groin and your abdomen. Feel your stomach and chest. Feel your arms and hands. Feel your neck and your shoulders. Feel your jaw and your head. And take a deep breath in and let go. One more deep breath in and let go. And we'll do it again. Let's feel your feet and feel your toes. Feel your calves and feel your thighs. Feel your groin and feel your abdomen. Feel your chest and feel your shoulders. Feel your arms and feel your hands. Feel your neck, feel your shoulders. Feel your jaw and feel your head. And take a deep breath in and let go. One more deep breath in and let go. We'll do it one more time. Feel your feet and feel your toes. Feel your calves and feel your thighs. Feel your groin and feel your abdomen. Feel your stomach and feel your chest. Feel your arms, feel your hands. Feel your neck and feel your shoulders. Feel your jaw and feel your head. And take a deep breath in and let go. And one last deep breath in and let go. Whenever you're ready, you can come back. Open your eyes. So with this one, you know, a very easy body scan. You know, if you're in your office, you're in between meetings, you're feeling a little bit stressed or overworked, or just like you need a little mental break, a really easy one, you know. Turn your chair from maybe the door, and it really took maybe 2 or 3 minutes just to kind of scan your body, see where things are. If you're feeling a little stressed, you can move your neck and shoulders wherever your tension wells up. I know for me it's my neck and shoulders. You know, stretching that out a little bit, just giving yourself a little mental break to scan your body and notice what's going on. And even the deep breathing in between each one of those really helps in bringing you back into the moment breath back into the present, and the mind, the breath and mind connection really can be strong. It's a really easy tool to use for yourself. And let's do one last one. This body scan and breathing is really just kind of noticing for your body. Let's do one that's a little bit more focused on the breathing. This is a little bit more of a meditation. With meditation, people often ask, you know, how do we do it? What are we trying to do? This one, all we're trying to do is focus on your breath. So you're going to sit back again comfortably, feet on the floor, back straight. And just to think about before you go into the meditation, you know, you might notice your mind wandering. You might notice you'll be thinking about other things. Every time you notice that happens, just bring it back to noticing your breath. Okay, so I notice I'm breathing in, I'm breathing out, I'm breathing in, I'm breathing out, and then, oh, you know, right after this call, I have to go X, 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 X. Just notice that your mind went there and then say, okay, I'm going to notice my breathing in and my breathing out. Okay, so just a tool to help us get back into the moment, practicing some of the meditation technique. Okay, so this one, I am not going to be talking so much. I will be guiding you a little bit through the process. Really, I just want you for 3 minutes to notice your breath and the activity going on in your mind. Again, this is not to shut off the mind or to meditation is not so that your mind completely shuts off, but it's really to just get to the present and the now. Notice what's going on in your mind and let it go. Notice what's going on in your mind, let it go, and come back to the breath. Okay, so let's get started. And then we'll do this for a little 3 minutes just as a way to focus on your breath. Take a deep breath in, close your eyes, feet on the floor. Take a deep breath in and let go. Another deep breath in and let go. And just begin to notice your breathing. In and out, in and out. And as you relax more into the space, just continue to focus on the breathing. Notice the mind wandering. Gently bring it back to the breath. With no judgment at oneself, if the mind might continue to move around, just each time bring it gently back. Back to the breath. In and out. In and out. Allowing yourself the time and the gift of time to be in the present moment. Enjoying being in the space of just being. Allowing yourself to be very present. Enjoying the mental break. As we come to the end of the 3 minutes, just take a deep breath in and out. And one more deep breath in. And out. And then come back to the present moment whenever you're ready. Back to opening your eyes. Just another useful tool. Again, this can be done in a very short amount of time. Meditation, you know, is a practice. You know, every time we do it, our minds, we notice, especially in the beginning, many of you, some of you are medium practitioners of some of this, half of you, so this might be something that you're doing. For some of you that are beginners and new to some of these tools, really it takes some time to build up the muscle. And I can talk a little bit about that. But it's not that your mind will immediately shut off. Okay, so just as a quick back to the state of mind, now that you've done a couple of these techniques, any change? Any change in your state of mind? Jot down what happened for you there after you've done a couple of these little techniques. All right. And just next steps. You know, as I was mentioning, mindfulness takes practice. And it's almost like a daily practice that we have to make, because that so all those statistics of things actually shifting were happening over 6, 7, 8 weeks. And as I've mentioned, I've been doing this for 10 years. 10 years of off and on. I wouldn't say I was completely on all the time, but for the last year, I've been every single day meditating and doing breathing exercises, which to me has really shifted so much in terms of the emotional intelligence capacity. Just one last quote for you from Daniel Goleman. It really is like a mental gym where you have to keep lifting the weight to make the muscle grow. Seeing your mind wander and bringing it back is really the process. You know, you let it go and then you come right back non-judgmentally as we had it with our definition in the present. So just take the time out, practice. You know, if you want more information, here at MTI we do offer leadership training courses that incorporate mindfulness. These are some of the courses that we teach, 4-hour sessions that can be tailored to that time frame or even day-long sessions on these topics, including emotional intelligence, well-being would be a whole session on mindfulness-type topics. And we can also do EQI assessments as well. So with that, I am going to open it up for Q&A. My information's here, so if we don't get to all of your questions, certainly feel free to reach out to me afterwards.
Thank you so much, Monica. Fantastic presentation. I loved the mindfulness exercise as well. Let's go ahead and get started with the Q&A. And just a reminder for those of you who have not yet sent in a question, go ahead and send those through now. Monica, we have a question that from an alum. They would like some examples of how practicing mindfulness in positions of leadership in one's career can prove effective. If you could shed some light, maybe tell about some of the experiences that you've had working with certain clients or with some of the organizations themselves.
Yeah, okay, great question. Definitely in my coaching, I've used mindfulness tools in the past. If I notice my clients are very anxious or stressed as we're talking about a topic, and in a particular leadership role where either they're trying to make a decision or they're fighting fires constantly and they're constantly in their head, often just taking a moment to step back and doing a couple breathing techniques like I walked you through, or the body scan that I just walked you through, brings them back to a centered place so that when we re-talk about it, they can get back into either their gut instincts or their body, which often will help get you to a better decision. I was just teaching a class this morning, and we were talking about neuroscience. You know, with anything going on in the brain, when we're in very hyper situations, stress or change, it can really start triggering the old emotional responses that we have. And so they often say just getting yourself to a place where you're not constantly overanalyzing or thinking about it can really help dampen down those old emotional responses. So practicing the mindfulness tools then help lessen that overactivity of the brain so that leaders then are making better decisions. They're coming back to a calm state so that they can think through a problem better and make better decisions. Same thing in training classes. I use this with a lot of leaders where they're stressed or over anxious, and we'll do a 5-minute mindfulness activity, like a meditation or a guided meditation that I just walked you through, and all of a sudden, that state of mind that I showed you, somebody immediately came and moved that state of mind up, you know, multiple spots on the state of mind. They immediately felt better. Okay, and if you imagine that state of mind process, if you're at a -3 and you're trying to have a conversation, let's say a performance conversation with a staff member, how well do you think that performance conversation is going to go if you're in a -3 state of mind? Not very well. Okay, but if you do some mindfulness techniques to bring you back to the present, calm your emotional state, when we talk about self-control and emotional self-awareness on the emotional intelligence scales, your ability to have a good conversation is going to go up. If you're at a +1, +2, +3, your performance conversation is going to be that much better. Okay, so some practical examples of how it impacts leadership.
Wonderful, Monica. Thank you so much. Do you have any suggestions as to how one might help bridge that gap with colleagues who don't themselves practice mindfulness, but if that's something that you make as a daily part of your routine, what are some ways that you can talk about it that might encourage those around you to practice this as well and therefore make the work environment that much more productive?
Yeah, that's a great question. I wish we could get everybody to mindfulness, right? That's why I started this. It's almost like a mission for me because I do notice the benefits in myself and the people around me. So, you know, that's why today I've presented it in multiple ways. I think some people really respond to the data, making the business case on really what's important and why the impacts of it and how it can help them. Using data or research is often a good way to influence other people towards something. The second way is through the experience, and that's why I gave you both the science and the experience, because to me also sometimes just walk them through the body scan. It took 2 minutes, right? Just do it with them and talk through it. Feel your feet, feel your toes, feel all parts of your body so that they feel the experience and have it resonate for themselves. Sometimes they have to go through that themselves in order to help them feel a little bit better. So take them to a yoga class. Take them to a meditation class. Bring a guided meditation. Organizations, even in the government, I do a lot of government consulting, have mindfulness programs. They have meditation rooms. Department of Treasury, NIH, so they'll have rooms there dedicated to mindfulness or meditation, and so it's just an hour at lunch where they can go and meditate for some time, or there's yoga classes, or join, you know, going to take a walk at lunch, so it helps calm the system down so that when they come back, the environment is that much better.
Monica, you just touched briefly on some of the things that organizations may do to encourage mindfulness in the workplace, such as these meditation rooms, and I have noticed that with startups in particular, that is, it's an essential. You find that in a lot of these younger startup companies. Can you talk about some of the other ways, aside from perhaps the more extensive mindfulness programs, but is this a conversation that should come from HR? Is this something that business leaders and managers should become more comfortable with addressing with their direct reports?
Yeah, I really think a lot of this can start at any direction, but leaders have a lot of influence, you know, meaning they can model it first by doing it themselves and people noticing the change in them. When they're doing the tools, that people might see it and start asking questions. I think if there are things that they feel like they want their staff to do with their direct reports, it could be something that they bring in as a tool. Hey, let's in a staff meeting, I've learned something new and I'd love for you all to experience it and offer it as a staff training, you know, or bring in an outside vendor or someplace where you can even bring in somebody to help guide you through something for an hour so that people get the experience of it. So I think as a leader, it doesn't have to be at the organizational level, leaders have a lot of influence over their direct reports, or they can manage up with their bosses, or they have the ability to build the relationships with their peers if they feel like this is something that they're noticing. So I think it can also be in one-on-one situations. It doesn't have to be at the organizational level where leaders can bring it into their space because they have influence. Just like I bring it into my coaching sessions or my training sessions, because at some point there's a level of comfortability or trust that maybe we don't start there if they're not comfortable, but after a while, if we've built some trust and transparency in the environment, they're willing to go along with me to test something out.
Thank you, Monica. Do you have any knowledge of apps that our alums can download for their phones that can help facilitate this practice of mindfulness? Are there certain apps that you would recommend over others?
Yes, there are definitely a lot of apps out there. The one often that I hear about and I have downloaded on my phone as well is called Headspace. So that's a really easy one to leverage. It has some guided meditations there. I also, as I mentioned, I volunteer with the Art of Living organization. They do a lot of breathing and meditation techniques. They have an app as well called Sattva, S-A-T-T-V-A. Again, they have many sorts of guided meditations out there. So those are two that I use. I know there must be multiple other ones, but those are definitely two places to start.
Fantastic. Monica, thank you so much. Thank you for all of the time that you have put into this presentation and in giving this presentation today to our alumni and for all of our Hoyas who are on the line. Thank you so much for joining us for Monica's presentation. And as I mentioned earlier, I will be sending along a copy of the recording, so you will have that in your files, and you can certainly visit us on our YouTube channel and check out over 450 archived webinars. And I will also include a link to Monica's previous webinar on emotional intelligence because it was just as excellent. So again, Monica, thank you so much.
Thanks, Kara. It's been a pleasure. Thanks, everyone.
Hoya Sacks, everyone. See you soon.